third way.
You want, we're back.
Okay. Tell me when.
Yeah, you can go.
The topic tonight is five ways to improve your running. So the first way is to have a goal. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. The second way is to set up a plan that allows you to move step by step through the program. And setting up the plan, start at your current fitness level, gradually increase towards your goal, write down the key workouts in a journal or on your calendar and interact with it at least every other day. For speed, include form drills, speed workouts, and race rehearsal workouts to learn pace. Use the strategy of run, walk, run that's based on your pace per mile. And you'll find, if you hadn't used run, walk, run, that it's going to help you recover faster, be able to run faster in races, and to gain control over your training program. You don't have to be out of commission. You don't have to hurt all the time with the right run, walk, run. Any questions on the setting up of a plan that I just mentioned?
You schedule your run, walk, run to your level, or to your, what did you say?
Based on your level of fitness. And this is determined by a component. You can either use a race, or you can use a training component that I developed called the Magic Mile. The Magic Mile is an amazing predictor, and we have a computation function on our website where you can plug in your time at the Magic Mile, and it will tell you what your current potential is in the 5K, the 10K, the half, and the full marathon. This prediction is based on now over 75,000 people have told us what their Magic Mile time was, and then what their race times were at those various distances. So crunching the numbers, we have gotten a quite accurate way of being able to tell you what you're currently able to do. So the other way to do it is to use a current race distance. And if your goal for that season isn't the same, you can use our computation function also, because it will adjust for other distances.
Okay.
That's a very good question. Now, once you have determined what your goal is, then you can set up both pacing and the run-walk-run amounts. The pacing for long runs should be ultra slow. And we found that if you run the long runs 4 minutes per mile slower than you run in 5Ks, you lower your chance of getting injured to practically nothing. And if you run even a little faster than that 4 minutes, your risk rises. Taking the marathon pace, you add 2 minutes to that pace. And then once you get the long run pace, you can set up the amount of running and the amount of walking. And here it is. At a 9 minute per mile pace, it's run 2 minutes and walk 30 seconds. At 10 minutes per mile, run 90 seconds and walk 30 seconds. At 11 and 12 minutes per mile, it's run 60 seconds, walk 30, or run 45, walk 30, or a lot of people now are running 11 and 12 minutes per mile, running 30 seconds and walking 30 seconds. For a 13 and 14 minute per mile pace, it's either 30-30, 20-20, or 15-15, and all of those figures are in seconds. Yes, we have evolved based on the feedback of hundreds of thousands of people using the method to find that shorter segments allow you to recover faster and have more pizzazz in your legs at the end, so that you can be the passer instead of the passee. Moving forward to 15 minutes per mile, that would be run 15 seconds, walk 30 seconds, and with 16 minutes per mile, which is interesting for those who are in the Disney races, because the balloon ladies go at the 16-minute-per-mile pace, and that ratio would be 10 seconds running and 30 seconds of walking. Any questions on any of that?
Yes. So when you run, during those seconds, how fast do you run all out, or do you just run plodding along?
I can't tell you.
Okay.
And the reason is that we've done countless surveys on that, and what we have found is that almost everybody, when you're running in a group, a pace group, walks at a different pace. So consequently, everybody runs at a different pace in order to maintain the same overall pace. But by doing the race rehearsal segments, you can time yourself for half a mile or a quarter mile, and you can try different run, walk, run segments, and then figure out what you need to do to stay on that pace. And these have been really, really efficient at being able to allow you to do that. The way that these components are set up, the long runs are done on weekends, and you don't need to run the long run but every other weekend in the beginning. Then on the alternate weekend, the minimum is only 30 minutes, but if you're trying for a time goal, you would do the speed training on the non-long run weekends. There are only two other days a week that you would need to run to get a time goal. One of these is usually a Tuesday, in which you would do a gentle warm-up, then you would do some light drills, the cadence drill, the acceleration glider drill. These not only help improve your efficiency, but they warm you up for the workout. And after the drills, doing 4 to 8 of the rehearsals, where you're running right at race pace, and then you're trying different run, walk, run configurations, either a quarter mile or a half mile, and you would walk 2 to 3 minutes in between those quarter or half mile race rehearsals. And that's a Tuesday. On Thursday, the usual format would be similar to Tuesday on the warm-up, and after the drills, to do some hills, to get your hill running form down so that you don't pound yourself or beat yourself up when you go up a hill. Any questions on any of that? These are all really good questions. So the number three in the five ways to improve, get out there 3 times a week. And I say that because one of the most common deficits that I see in runners, as I talk to them, I average over 100 emails a day. And over again, people will say, well, why am I not improving? So I'll ask them a battery of questions. And the most common reason is they're not running but once a week or sometimes less for several weeks. You have to go every other day because your body will adapt to what you do regularly. But if you don't do it regularly, you start to lose those adaptations. So anyway, 3 days a week is sufficient. And then you put into each one of those days the components that I just mentioned that can give you the ability that you need, either race pace or with form drills, running efficiency. But I will talk about that in a bit. So your body is designed to keep adapting if you keep running. And the walk breaks will not take anything away from that. They actually keep you from sloughing off on your form so that you can stay more efficient. Have variety in your runs. I just suggested different things that you can do to improve on Tuesday and on Thursday, and then different weekend workouts. But find scenic courses. Run with funny or interesting people. Have your own network of folks, and you'll enrich your life in so, so many ways. And change your course up. Don't run the same course every single day. Variety is the spice of running. Find some fun in every single run, and you'll want to get out there again. Okay, now for number four. 4 out of 5. Ain't bad. Gradually increase your long run every 2 to 3 weeks. It is a fact that the greatest benefit in training, the greatest training component that gives you more than anything else, it's not just stamina. You receive a treasure trove of physiological benefits from the long runs. And you also teach yourself a lot of logistics for race day. So it's a whole learning experience, and you're going to get the infrastructure. And that's where fat burning is developed, too. Now, I know that none of you need to burn any fat, but you know, if you have any friends that do, the long runs do it better than anything else. Okay, endurance is really the key to a goal. And so you want to build up that long run to at least race distance. But you're going to do better if you go beyond race distance. For example, in a half marathon, we found that those who used to run 10 miles and then in a future training program get up to 14 miles as their longest 2 weeks before, find that they average running about 7 minutes faster in the half marathon by going from 10 miles longest run up to 14. In the marathon, those who used to run 20 miles as their longest run, when they go up to 26, an average of a 15-minute time improvement. It's huge. There's so many benefits. The long runs do not need to be run fast. As a matter of fact, running them fast is a great source of injury. It's the number one cause of injury in distance running. So I talked already about slowing down at least 4 minutes per mile slower than you run in 5Ks. And for the marathon, you want to slow down at least 2 minutes per mile slower than you're running in marathons. You cannot go too slow on long runs, and you cannot walk too much on long runs. I coach several dozen people every year who walk every one of their long runs, and they have all the endurance they need when they get into their race. The only issue then in the race is pacing yourself. But you've got the endurance, even if you just walk. And walking then becomes the default mode, so that if you hit a wall, don't just stop there, just walk it in, and you'll still get all the endurance. So finally, number five, evaluate and adjust. And this involves looking at your cognitive tools that you use, and the training journal is the best tool that you can have to evaluate and adjust. List your projected workouts in your journal each week. Write down then after the workout what you actually ran that week, because sometimes there's a discrepancy, and your memory doesn't usually do a good job of remembering those indiscretions. Next, make notes if there were problems or you had a very successful run. Try to figure out the reasons for either. And try to do it right away, because your mind is fresh and sharp at that point. Chart your magic mile progress. I mentioned earlier that the magic mile has been the best way to be able to predict. So chart that progress in your journal, and then it'll remind you what to shoot for on your next magic mile. Adjust if you miss workouts, are sick, injured, or have other interruptions. And learn from your mistakes. I've found in my coaching career that people learn a whole lot more from their mistakes than they learn from their successes. Because you adjust, you go back through your journal, you write down what you need to do next time, and you've got a much better chance of actually pulling that off. So, what do you have about anything in terms of getting better? Nobody wants to get better? Okay.
So what, so like if you're training for a half marathon and you're gonna go out and do 14 miles, to walk 14 miles, that, how many hours does that take?
How fast you walk?
Of you, yeah.
Just to give you a reference, the average pace in the groups that we work with is a 20-minute mile. 20-minute mile.
The average pace?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah, it takes a while, but if you've got a problem, and let's say that you weren't able to do two of your long runs, there's still hope of being able to get the mileage up for your race if you walk the next long run, and it can catch you up right away.
That's a long,
long walk every day.
Not seeing any pictures.
Find a beautiful path to go on.
Go with a friend.
Oh, there's one. Can you read it?
But it wasn't her doing this run walk, and I think that's where a lot of us fail. We feel like we have to run the whole thing the whole time.
Let me get into that, because this is a major point that I hear. I'm hearing less of it now than I did 10 years ago, because run walk run is taking over. But the point is that according to the anthropologists that study ancient man, we really weren't designed for running nonstop. Our ancestors walked wherever they went. The reason? Because the primary cause of death was starvation until very recently. And so they weren't about to use up their resources by running all over the place. They walked everywhere. And we're brilliant at walking long distances. Running, however, because our bone structure and joints and a lot of other things weren't designed for non-stop running. That's why we get injured, along with a few other things, but that's one of the primary reasons we get injured, non-stop running. By the insertion of a walk break early and often, you keep erasing the stress buildup on weak links. You also save the muscle resources, so you're the one that has those at the end of your race or your workout. And you can recover fast. You never have to be out of commission if you have the right run, walk, run.
So we'll test this out at the next Atlanta half.
Good.
Or at your December
one, yes.
And I'll get my PR under 2 hours.
Come to our race in December. We have a wonderful 5K. It's Barb's 5K on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Nice medal there. And then we have an amazing medal. Where is our medal from?
It's back there, isn't it?
From last year. It is, yes, it's on the wall back there.
That big one?
Yeah.
Ooh, we're
yeah,
doing that one.
That is our
that's the weekend after
the half.
Well, that was 5 years.
From last December.
Oh, yeah.
But it is still available by virtual. So you can use your performance in another half marathon over the last year to win this medal. Just go to jeffgalloway.com and hit the JG 13.1, and Barb's 5K is also available by virtual too.
That's good to know.
any other questions? Any other things that I can help you with? I'm here to help solve problems.
You were talking about speed work. I know at the Ansley store they go and do speed work, but is there anything wrong here? Where you could just do like tempo or anything?
Want me to explain what I believe to be the best speed work?
More like, is there a group that does speed work?
Not out of this store, at least not out of this time. At this time, there are some of our Galloway training program people that will meet from time to time here, but it's not on a regular basis.
How long do you suggest running for a speed run, like when you're just, like I'm
depends on the distance of the race that you're training for. For 5K and 10K, I found that quarter mile repetitions are the best for that. And they should be done for best result once a week. The workouts gradually build up. You can walk for half a lap or about an eighth of a mile in between. And build up the number of them. Start with four of them, add two each workout, and build up to 14 for a 5K time goal, and 18 to 20 for a, thank you, for a 10K time goal. In the half marathon, I found that half mile repetitions have been more productive. And so those start on alternate weekends with the long run. So they're done every other week at first. And they start with four, you add two additional each workout, and you build the total number up to 14 by the end of the season. In the marathon, the format is the same, only you're running 1 mile repetitions instead of half mile repetitions. And you start with four, add two additional, build up to 14 by the end of the season.
But when you're doing this quarter or half or mile or whatever, you're doing the race, the run block method in the speed workout?
Well, for the quarter miles, it's not necessary to do that. But for the halves and the miles, it has been much more productive to use walk breaks. And it really helps you recover faster from those really long walk breaks. Now, let's just say, though, that you have determined from the race rehearsal component on Tuesday that a 60-second run and a 30-second walk is what you're going to use in the race. During the half mile or mile repeats, you'd run 60 seconds, but you'd only walk half of that. So you'd walk 15 seconds instead of 30. And the reason is you want the workouts to be a little harder. And also, the pace of those halves or fulls should be about 30 seconds per mile faster than you want to run when you get into your race itself. So you've got to pick up that pace somehow.
So in the speed, then you would just do that short run as fast as you can?
Nope. You want to run about 30 seconds per mile faster than you want to run in the race itself, which isn't that much faster, especially in the marathon.
Okay.
30 seconds per mile faster than marathon pace is not that fast. So, but as the number of these grow, then you really have to dig down towards the end of those workouts, and that's where you really develop the capacity to do that when you get into the race itself.
So if I do in a half, if I do like 9.5 minute miles, I want to do like 9.
Yes, that's correct.
And do it for like a minute?
It would be for the marathon, it would be a 1 mile repetition, walking 5 minutes between, and do another one. For the half marathon, it would be a half mile repetition, so you run that
half
in 4:30, and then you would walk 3 minutes between the half miles.
But this is all on your website.
It is. It's on jeffgalloway.com. You'll also find in my training books, which we have a year-round plan, 5K, 10K, and half marathon are all delineated out. Anything else?
Do you know, what's the difference between threshold and like, what's the other one? They always say do like threshold runner or different pace running, and I'm like, what's the difference between that and speed run?
Well, if you ask 10 different coaches what the components should be, you'll find 10 different answers.
Okay.
So, what my method is a very simple plan, but it does get the job done, and it has about 500,000 people who've reported back to me over the years who've been successful with this. So we have a good record behind us.
So run, walk, lower, long runs you can do slower, and walk it even to that.
Yep.
Okay. And
all you're doing,
workout.
All you're trying to
one,
do
two,
on the long runs is go the distance,
distance
that's assigned.
Okay.
And you need to do them slowly so that you can recover, so that you can do the other elements of the program after, you know, during the next week. Good question. Anything?
Jeff, if you've been training with the run, walk, run, and then you go to do a race, how do you discipline yourself not to get caught up in all the hype and run like everybody else? I can run for the first 2 miles and then start my run walk.
This gets back to which brain component are you going to put in charge. You can choose to start of a race, allow their ancient subconscious brain to be in control. And so when the gun fires and everybody takes off, if you allow the ancient brain to be in control, it's going to search for the first time when you learned how to do a given activity, which is probably on the playground racing another kid, and you take off and you go too fast, and guess what happens? You crash and burn later on. And it's because you didn't activate your human brain. Well, the best way to do that is to set your timer, and we have a bunch of timers here that will beep and vibrate and tell you when to take the walk break. So as you move over to the side of the road and wave your hand, you break the cycle of going too fast. And you keep yourself under control. And during the walk break, you can use positive mantras. I'm feeling good. I'm erasing the fatigue that's been building up. I'm going to pass these people at the end.
I can't read them very well.
You will.
So
but
even
you have to use cognitive tools to be able to activate that human brain.
And you still feel even if you run a faster race, even though you do the walk longer.
Can you read them?
Numerous surveys,
you
the average improvement in a half marathon from nonstop runners that found the right run, walk, run is about 7 minutes faster.
All right.
And in a full marathon, 13 minutes faster.
Well, what am I doing?
Does it work for a 10K?
Yeah, I want
to
do that.
10K,
yeah.
It's about 2 to 4 minutes, depending on the survey.
Okay.
So there's still
this
benefit.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So we have a question from somebody watching, from Denise Hidalgo. Says, could you please offer tips from your experience when you recovered from injury and just added 5 seconds running per minute for those of us who are training at 5:20 or 10:30 and find these extremely short intervals very challenging?
Well, Denise is not only a member of our New York training program, but also joins us at our wonderful Tahoe retreat every year. Denise, thanks for the question. When you're coming back from an injury, the number one rule is to stay below the threshold of further irritation. So you start by walking. And again, as I said before about walking the long runs, you will gain all of the endurance even if you walk every step of the long run. So it's a really great segue to be able to get into the endurance that you need for a given goal. And you can usually stay below the threshold when you're walking these long ones. And then when your body's ready to insert the run segments, we found that the shorter segments, when you use a shuffle, have been the easiest to keep you from breaking down. So 5 seconds, 7 seconds, 10 seconds, followed by 30 seconds of walking to 60 seconds of walking. And so you just have to try the shorter ones first. The reason why the shorter ones are used is that when people come back from an injury and try to run too far, they usually reactivate the injury. So we're just trying to ease people back and let the body adapt. And this again goes back to what we were designed to do. If you force yourself to run farther than you're ready to run at any given point in time, things break. And unfortunately, they take a long time to heal up. So anyway, ease back into it.
Jeff, can you tell the people about the Tahoe retreats, when they are, and how we handle that?
Yes. I tell you, I have not found any place in the world, and I have gone to a lot of places during the summertime all over the world, but I've not found any place that is as nice and as great for running as the Lake Tahoe area. We go out there at the end of July, first part of August. The high temperatures are usually up in the high 70s, early 80s, and the humidity is 10%. Can you believe that?
Yeah.
10% coming from here in Atlanta and going out to Tahoe is like living in air conditioning every day. Sunny every day, and it's just a great group of people. But we do have structured sessions, as we do in Carmel four times a year on weekends and also on the Panhandle of Florida. At Tahoe, we're there for a week, and you don't want to leave. It is just so wonderful to train there. We have trails that are simply magnificent. The vistas, the beautiful forest that you run through, and then the ability to run along Lake Tahoe, it's fabulous.
Is it south or north of Tahoe?
North Shore. We're actually headquartered out of Squaw Valley, but we go to a different trail system every day, so you get a lot of variety on where to go. Anything else?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Does it really make a difference if you run heel to toe versus toe to heel? My boyfriend always tells me that I run incorrectly because I land on my heels. Does it make a difference?
I don't want to get in between you and your boyfriend, but he's wrong. Okay. He's wrong according to the research that goes back 75 years. And what the research says is that if you run the natural way for you, that you're going to tend to run more efficiently, you're going to have fewer aches and pains, and you're going to be able to run faster. Okay. If you change that, bad things happen. And a lot of people assume that you're not going to run fast if you land on your heels. Well, I've got something to show you. That picture on the wall on the far left over there is a picture of myself running with a good friend of mine, Steve Prefontaine. He was on my Olympic team in 1972. Steve landed solidly on his heel. He didn't run that slow. He was the first man in the 3 mile to get into the 12s. He broke 13 minutes in the 3 mile. Run the way that's natural.
Okay. That's good.
Anything else? Great questions.
That is good.
And thanks for tuning in. Any follow-up, just go to jeffgalloway.com. Onward.